There's something going on, and we don't fully understand it. Many people don't even know about it, and many who are aware choose not to believe it. It's always been this way, but could that possibly be by design? Well, hello. Oh, you're wondering why I'm an avatar? That's funny. I was about to ask the same thing about you. That's right. Today we're going to talk about how your body is like an avatar for your soul. How you are not a person with a soul, but rather a soul who is currently incarnating in, well, in you. There, that's better. You have questions about the soul, and so do I. We all do. But let's not rely on sparse records of prophets from thousands of years ago, translated from archaic languages and revised by politicians. We no longer need to. Numerous modern-day people seem to be able to access the information we seek, and perhaps we all can if we learn how to unlock it. People with spiritual insights get their knowledge through a misunderstood phenomenon. Throughout history, it has gone by many names: prophecy, channeling, oracles, visions, shamanism, communing with the higher power, divine intervention, precognition, revelations, mediumship, clairaudience, near-death experiences. Maybe you believe in the Bible, Torah, Quran, Bhagavad Gita, or maybe not. Either way, I hope you can grant me that something happened way back in biblical times. And it must have been pretty darn interesting for the stories to be handed down for thousands of years when little else was. So ask yourself this: why do many people assume that the prophecies are over? Does that even make sense? Would a timeless God reveal itself and guide us for thousands of years and then shut the door? The evidence says otherwise. Be open-minded. Forget what you think you know about heaven and hell, ghosts, the spirit world, the soul. We have information sources very similar to those recorded for thousands of years available to us today. But unlike those sources of old, these have no translation errors, outdated metaphors, or books lost along the way. According to Matthew 7, Jesus said, "Everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened." I believe that means if you're curious, you will be given the answers you seek. But why me, Rob Simperman? Well, as a management consultant for over 20 years, my job is to make sense of complex questions and explain them in simple terms. Clients need to be able to make their own decisions based on the best information from an objective outsider. So on the topic of the soul, I was raised Catholic, then became agnostic about God, and skeptical of anything science hadn't confirmed. I wanted evidence, so I sought my own. I studied and practiced Buddhism. I read voraciously about many of the sources of spiritual information, including those you'll meet shortly. And I even tried several energetic and Eastern healing approaches. I even personally tried regression hypnosis to remember my own past lives. And what I concluded? So there really is overwhelming evidence of the soul and reincarnation too. So I looked for the most prolific, well-documented, and clear-spoken individuals from the past 100 years. These spiritual experts demonstrated access to information about the nature of reality, the soul, God, what happens after death, our health, the purpose of our lives, and what's in store for the future of mankind, which I found shocking. Collectively, I refer to this handful of key individuals as our modern prophets. These five in particular provide a fascinating cross-section of spiritual insights that passed my sniff test for authenticity, relevancy, clarity, motivation, and most surprising, consensus, even on most of the details. So I first picked three mediums to highlight: Edgar Cayce, Jane Roberts, and Paul Selig, who each had many thousands of channeling sessions. These were documented in 10 to 20 books each over several decades. But we shouldn't believe just a few people on such lofty questions. So I then chose two pioneers of regression hypnotherapy, Michael Newton and Dolores Cannon. They each developed techniques to turn the masses into mediums, to pierce the so-called veil of amnesia that makes us forget our soul memories when being born human. They each piece together an impressive understanding of the divine through sessions with thousands of different clients or subjects, and their organizations trained thousands of practitioners who continue to do so today. That was hard for me to believe. So I personally had hypnosis sessions using both Cannon and Newton certified practitioners. And I too recalled memories and emotions of past lives with both methods. Then, even without being trained, I led a skeptical friend through the techniques used on me, and she recalled multiple past lives. And another friend did so with guided meditations on YouTube. But this film isn't about us. Still skeptical? Glad to hear it. In fact, none of the mediums and hypnotherapists I highlight today started by trying to receive spiritual messages, and none believed in reincarnation until they stumbled upon the overwhelming evidence. So my investigation is ambitious. We'll explore questions including, who are these modern-day prophets? We'll look at whether they show any signs of being frauds, and how a typical person, and even a skeptic, can access spiritual insights with these techniques. What did they uncover about death and the spirit world? We'll explore the activities that come after death, and even after we're ready to move on beyond the cycle of incarnating on Earth altogether. What are the implications of being a soul? We'll look with fresh eyes at day-to-day life in terms of dealing with hardships, health, love, free will, and they'll explain karma too. And finally, what do they say about our own ability to ascend, both as individual humans and as the Earth as a whole? So I'm going to walk you through my findings and see if they change your way of thinking about life like they did for me. But before I present our spiritual experts, let's take a brief diversion. I plan to push the limits of your belief today, so let me plant a seed with a little thought experiment. Imagine a day in the distant future. Microsoft announces they teamed up with neurologists to invent a new virtual reality video game with an amazing new feature, temporary amnesia mode. While you're playing, you forget that you're in a game. You feel like you are the character. This lets you simulate any number of realistic scenarios to see how you would react when your life, your ego, and your loved ones are on the line. And it's a massively multiplayer online game, an MMO, so your friends and strangers can play parts in group missions with you. But don't worry, it's perfectly safe. When each life is over, you respawn back to your living room. It takes a little while to reorient yourself, but then you become fully aware of every time that you played this game previously. You're able to reflect on the experiences with your friends and get guidance from a coach. Then you update your plans for the next life as part of a curriculum for you and your classmates, or take some time off for other activities outside the game lab. Would you play? Maybe even use it as a tool for education, socialization, testing morality in different scenarios? Think of this game called Reincarnation, if you will, as a valuable tool for self-improvement. And what would be the nature of such a video game world? Maybe made out of rough blocks like Minecraft or the new metaverse worlds? But more likely tiny pixels like the best VR games today. Or maybe much, much more realistic. And if you look closer and closer at those pixels, or subatomic particles, you'd see a different set of physics underneath it all. A world of waves, vibrations, and energy. You may be saying that scientists would have noticed if a new structure underpinned our world of matter, an energy wave world eerily similar to the spirit world that many report glimpses of. To that I say, but they have. You are living in a physical world constructed atop an energy world. Have you heard of quantum physics, the double slits experiment, Schrodinger's cat, string theory? We now know that matter collapses back into waves of energy whenever no one's observing it. That's been accepted scientific fact, though one of the weirder facts, for decades. Perhaps science is finally pulling the covers off the truth, and the physical world is a construct atop an energy world. Perhaps Mario will one day look into your living room and introduce himself to the people on the couch holding the controllers. Imagine what he would think of you, and himself knowing that he's part of you. Such a development would usher in a new era of humanity, a big leveling up, so to speak. Even a new Earth? Let that percolate in your mind for now. So, is God dead? Or have the reports of his demise been an exaggeration? resume our investigation. There have been countless well-documented cases of dialogue with the divine over the centuries since the primary holy texts were written. For example, Emanuel Swedenborg, a Swedish scientist in the 1700s, channeled over 30 books and treatises about our soul and salvation from spirit sources. He claimed the messages aligned with the purest, though forgotten, forms of the Christian teachings. He even convinced a court to acquit him of heresy charges based on the value of his messages and predictions. Another post-biblical prophet was Nostradamus. He's best known for his 942 poetic, if often vague, predictions. But in a strange twist, one of our other hypnotherapist sources for this documentary, Dolores Cannon, published 1,100 pages of dialogue with Nostradamus' soul across time. One major conclusion was that the timeline he foresaw was among the worst-case scenarios for mankind, much of which have been averted already. But now, let's jump into the past 100 years and meet our first primary spiritual source, Edgar Cayce, the so-called sleeping prophet. Edgar Cayce grew up in Hopkinsville, Kentucky in the late 1800s. He worked the farm, then various low-level jobs in his youth and a young adulthood. He was a devout and practicing Christian. He even read the entire Bible every year and prayed at the beginning of every one of his channeling sessions. In fact, his faith meant that he was shocked when information about reincarnation was revealed to him, taking years to accept it as true. So how did that young boy become a prolific spiritual healer and full-time medium who founded multiple institutes? His source, as he called it, was his own subconscious, superconscious, or universal mind. Though on a dozen occasions, other entities communicated through him, including one claiming to be the Archangel Michael. A 13-year-old Cayce spent a day praying and reviewing his beloved Bible story about the vision of Manoah and Samson. That night, he was visited by a gloriously bright figure at the foot of his bed. He thought it was his mother and went to her room, but she confirmed it wasn't her. So he went back to his room and saw her again. This time she spoke to Cayce. "Thy prayers are heard, and you will have your wish. Remain faithful. Be true to yourself. Help the sick, the afflicted." The next day, he began attaining a near photographic memory, and in the following years, he developed as an intuitive healer. He started performing readings for individuals seeking guidance. While Cayce is best known for holistic healing and predictions, he also advanced the practices of astral projection, mediumship, and seeing auras, bringing many of these concepts to larger audiences for the first time. He amassed over 14,000 documented readings from 1924 to 44, but likely did about 6,000 more. He achieved popularity and a long waiting list for his readings. In fact, he's considered by many to have launched the New Age movement. His key messages can be summed up as oneness of all life. He also said, "Life is purposeful, as we are born to bring the creative, spiritual world into the daily material world. Life requires taking responsibility and having compassion and ideals, not getting stuck in ego-driven competition." Next, let's meet Jane Roberts. She took Cayce's spiritual populism to a new level with tens of thousands of pages of text, all fairly easy to read by the masses. Her New York Times bestsellers were channeled as completely pre-edited books. They used modern language and are even witty at times. Often I'll refer to her messages as coming from Seth, the disembodied entity that she channeled. Roberts grew up in Saratoga Springs, New York. She was exposed to Catholicism at an orphanage and by priests during her difficult childhood, but she primarily embraced science over religion. She attended Skidmore College on a poetry scholarship and went on to write poetry, short stories, children's literature, nonfiction, and novels. Jane and her artist husband lived and worked in their two-bedroom apartment a block from the Chemung River in Elmira, New York. For Jane Roberts, it all began in 1963. While writing poetry, she had a spontaneous out-of-body experience that flooded her mind with astonishing new ideas. Afterwards, she discovered her hands had been automatically writing a passage titled, "The Physical Universe as Idea Construction." Searching for an explanation, she experimented with the Ouija board. After several sessions, the pointer began spelling out messages from a personality called Seth. Within a month, she was directly speaking aloud for Seth while in trances. Like Cayce, she remembered very little of the content after a session. Seth described himself as an advanced spirit, a teacher on many planes of existence. Seth knew Jane and her husband's souls from prior incarnations together, and as a surprising twist, always addressed Jane by the masculine name he knew her by best, Rupert. Jane Roberts had 1,500 sessions channeling Seth, some private, some with guests, some with her ESP class that she taught at the local college. These 1,500 sessions produced the content of 10 books dictated by Seth in their entirety, plus 12 collections of standalone sessions published as books, and 8 other books dictated in altered states of consciousness. The key message from Seth is we create our own reality through our beliefs. Some of our beliefs are deeply entrenched, like those that we deserve poverty versus wealth, or love versus rejection. Others are shared across all humanity and practically impossible to change on our own, like that time moves forward, or that gravity pulls things down. He also taught that we have an oversoul with perspective across our numerous lives. It can explore the infinite variations of reality created by what we focus on. We can contact that oversoul with practice, but are usually operating on our own here on Earth. Yet our spirit world support structure is just behind the scenes of our perception, where we visit during dreams and even between lives. Next, consider another medium who's still going strong, Paul Selig. Like Roberts and Cayce, Selig focused on spiritual philosophy and challenges our religious assumptions. An affirmed atheist, Selig started out as an academic with degrees from NYU and Yale. He served as a writing professor at NYU for over 25 years and was also a playwright. Selig's spiritual career began in 1987 when he developed a clairvoyant ability and began studying energy healing. Then in 2009, a voice from his guides invited him to channel a book called I Am the Word over a 2-week period. 9 more channeled books followed so far. Selig channels each fully edited manuscript over a 2-to-4-week period. Selig enters a self-induced trance and channels a collective that calls itself the Ascended Masters. They claim to have been present on this plane for thousands of years in different forms. Their key messages are, a radical shift in human consciousness is available to us if we can understand the Christ as a consciousness, a frequency to align to. Several religious figures, including Jesus, should be considered such personifications of this Christ consciousness, given to us as examples of what's possible for all of us. And aligning to the Christ consciousness is our legacy, our destiny as humans.
It means your life becomes prayer, and to be in prayer, and to be in prayer is to operate in awareness of union.
Cayce, Roberts, Selig, and for that matter, Swedenborg and Nostradamus, became experts at entering trance states during their thousands of sessions. However, formal hypnosis techniques assist even the most novice subjects in doing similar. As is often said, all hypnosis is self-hypnosis. The only skill needed as a subject is to describe all images that flow through your mind without judgment. Dr. Newton describes how, when subjects are in a trance, their brain waves slow from the beta wake state down past the meditative alpha state and into the theta range. Theta is hypnosis, not sleep, which is the delta stage. In theta trances, the conscious mind has access to all memory channels. It sees pictures and hears dialogues with the unconscious mind as literal observations. Subjects cannot lie, but may misinterpret what they see in the unconscious mind. And if the subjects were not truly in a trance and answering questions based on preconceived ideas or fantasy, they would be rife with contradictions and information certainly wouldn't be consistent across subjects. Cannon and Newton both found their subjects used similar words and graphic descriptions when describing soul experiences. Both agree that the spirit world, the world behind the veil of amnesia, is very difficult to express in limited human language. I suspect this has been a challenge for thousands of years, resulting in the many cryptic and metaphorical prophecies. Cannon and Newton's respective global organizations of practitioners are completely independent and can be thought of as two competing options for someone seeking subconscious healing and spiritual insights. To date, the Michael Newton Institute has a record of over 55,000 life between lives sessions, the method offered in over 40 countries in 25 languages by hundreds of trained facilitators. At the same time, over 100,000 students from more than 117 countries have taken Dolores Cannon's QHHT courses, each performing numerous sessions. While it was clear for many years that hypnosis could reveal glimpses of apparent past lives, the Newton-Cannon era took hypnotherapy much, much further. But how did they get started? Dr. Michael Newton was a counselor and certified master hypnotherapist. He specialized in behavior modifications for the treatment of psychological disorders. Like Roberts and Selig, he was a spiritual skeptic until he stumbled upon the therapeutic benefits of exploring past lives, and especially the interlife memories of his patients. Spiritual knowledge first came to him in the late 1960s. Dr. Newton regressed a hypnotherapy client who was seeking the source of his shoulder pain. Newton was shocked when the subject graphically described a bayonet injury in the World War I Battle of Somme as the source. Newton later confirmed the numerous details provided with keepers of war records in London. Later, Dr. Newton regressed a depression patient to her root cause and was told that she had to leave her soul group behind to learn independence during her next incarnation, which is her current life. These experiences opened the door for him to explore the therapeutic benefits of such interlife memories. While regressing his clients, he discovered that it's possible to get descriptions of the spirit world from the perspective of his subjects' superconscious minds. We'll explore those findings in depth, but the main themes were the Earth is like a schoolhouse for soul development, and a notoriously challenging one at that. There's a common series of steps between the time of death and the beginning of the next birth, the so-called interlife. Our significant life challenges are planned by us in consultation with our guides and a council of elders. And hypnotherapy lets us relive these memories for guidance and for healing. Dr. Newton wrote three books summarizing his Life Between Lives regression techniques and findings. The first book covers sessions with 7,000 people over 10 years, and the second covers another several thousand and new topics. I personally underwent the hypnosis approaches developed by both Michael Newton and Dolores Cannon. While different visualization techniques were used in each, I didn't notice any significant differences from the client perspective. The Michael Newton approach makes use of a series of techniques to bring us into total relaxation and the theta brainwaves. Visualize gradually moving back in time, such as walking down a staircase, where each step represents a year of our life. Get to 1 year, then 6 months, 3 months, then in the womb, then in a hallway where each door represents one lifetime. Open a door that feels important and describe what you see. When ready, fast forward to the death scene of that life, using various techniques to help us feel safe. After the death scene, explore the interlife memories. This includes illuminating conversations with guides, life reviews, planning discussions, and other activities we'll discuss soon. Next, let's meet our final primary spiritual information source, Dolores Cannon. Dolores Cannon was a Christian who attended church and taught Sunday school. Like Dr. Newton, she didn't believe in reincarnation or seek any spiritual insights when she learned hypnosis from her therapist husband. Then, in 1968, she and her husband discovered a subject could be regressed beyond their most recent birth to recall multiple past lives. She continuously refined her approach, conducting many thousands of sessions throughout the rest of her life. Cannon discovered more and more esoteric knowledge from the subconscious minds, or SC, of her subjects, and from other spiritual, physical, and even alien beings who spoke directly to her through her subjects. She even had entities speak to her through more than one client, resuming conversations across people who didn't know each other. Her approach uses different visualizations, such as riding on a cloud to an important place. She had less emphasis on past lives and more on bringing forth the higher self or subconscious for answers. But those are subtle differences, and her conclusions overlapped with Seth, Cayce, and Dr. Newton in particular. Cannon wrote 19 books, with others being published posthumously. They cover numerous metaphysical concepts, including that past lives can explain lessons and karmic ties that have an effect on our present life. The subconscious mind can heal, if asked, sometimes with miraculous-seeming results. The subconscious can teach us about life's purpose, the post-death process, and even the mechanics of the universe. She also delves very deeply into historical figures such as Jesus and Nostradamus, and explains extraterrestrials, the origin of life on Earth, and details of numerous alien and spiritual civilizations. Now, a reasonable response to all this would be to assume that these people are frauds. So let's look for clues. None lived extravagant lives. Cayce teetered on financial ruin his whole life. The majority of his readings were unpaid, and he did much of his work during the Great Depression and during two world wars. Roberts stayed in her Elmira apartment her entire career, while Cannon never left her small hometown in Arkansas. Selig and Newton had professional careers before their spiritual endeavors, but showed no sign of living beyond the means of people with similar careers. They all worked hard. The four who have passed conducted their work until their final year of life, as long as their health allowed. None moved on to anything at all after their spiritual journeys, much less leisurely retirement. They allowed spectators to observe sessions regularly, and three of the five had members of the public voicing their messages. They performed their work on stage, in classrooms, and on TV numerous times, where volunteer subjects were just as likely to be included in their books. The hypnotherapists taught others to perform their techniques, which continue after their deaths. And as I mentioned, even I was able to help someone recall past lives. A compelling fact to me is that three were basically atheists, and none of them believed in reincarnation when they got started. They had no obvious exposure to the idea, and all wrestled with accepting it. So that would make a pretty strange get-rich-quick scheme for them all to choose, don't you think? And finally, their messages agree with each other, and agree, more or less, with how the ancient religious texts could be interpreted too. So draw your own conclusion, but none of this screams out fraud to me. Instead, it points to them tuning in to an ever-present communication phenomenon. So let's assume that they at least deserve our attention, if not our full belief just yet. So then, what are their messages? What are they telling us? And what do their countless subjects reveal about our souls? You are a particular manifestation of a soul, and it is sheer nonsense to think that you must remain ignorant of the nature of your own being. So what? How does any of this help humanity? Direct spiritual knowledge has the potential to answer all of life's most fundamental questions, and I'm talking about the real biggies. What are we in terms of our true nature as human beings? Why are we here? For a particular reason? Where did humanity come from and where's it going? And what is this God concept that seems to follow us through so much history and culture? So let's dive in and look at what the modern prophets can unlock for us. Jane Roberts Seth, Edgar Cayce's higher self, Selig's ascendant masters, and our two regression hypnotherapists, who each represent thousands of perspectives, all provide insight on the death and rebirth process. Learning from them about the death transition reduces fear and helps our eventual transition go smoothly. It also helps us make sense of our current life experience. And Dr. Newton tells us, for those with a longing to know more, simple acceptance of life is totally unsatisfying. For some travelers, life's mysteries cry out for attention, if being alive is to have any meaning. So let's start with perhaps the most common preconception about the afterlife. Aren't we each just on a path to either heaven or hell? From what may anyone be saved? Only from themselves. That is their individual hell. They dig it with their own desires. Our spiritual experts agree that there is no hell. There is no personified evil or Satan, nor is there eternal damnation. The idea that good needs to be balanced by evil is just a rationalization for our fallibility by our logical minds. As Cannon's subjects tell her, there is no good or bad souls, only evolving souls. But some have bad lives. This is obvious to our higher selves, but our earthly minds get confused by ego and logic. Preconceived visuals, such as hell, do feature in some death glimpses for those who expect to see them. But that all falls away soon, as we adjust to the spirit world, our home as many call it. We soon realize the true nature of our spirit world situation. Then what of religions that push the idea of hell? This is counterproductive for spiritual growth. As Seth says, to liberate the soul means that one needs to be free and clear, and any religion that dictates a fear-based doctrine of hell and damnation cannot liberate a soul. One will never leave a house when one is told that what's outside the house will kill them. This is about freedom now. In fact, Paul Selig tells us that there is outrage in the higher dimensions that man created damnation for himself when there was meant to be love, and that we have been slaughtering innocents on earth in the name of God, who is nothing but love made manifest. And there isn't heaven either in those terms. Seth says that we may visualize a stereotyped heaven when glimpsing the doorway to the spirit world based on our preconceived ideas. As he describes it, existence demands development, and such a heaven would be sterile, boring, and indeed deadly. Now, there are upper astral levels that could be compared to heaven because they're so beautiful and filled with love. That's where you'd go after progressing beyond the entire cycle of Earth lives. But even there, there's plenty of work to do. It's very rare that one comes back to Earth from such a higher level, except to fulfill a narrative or a mission like Buddha or Jesus did. So our knowledge is limited. This may be where Seth comes from, and he assures us that death is no eternal resting place. In fact, he says his present existence is the most challenging he has ever known, and he has known many, both physical and non-physical. So if there is a spirit world, how do we get there? Life is a process of becoming, and death is a part of this process. Our sources of spiritual expertise agree that each life plan includes one or more exit points. People die when they are ready, for a specific reason, even if we're not consciously aware of these plans. There are no accidents when it comes to death. Seth described a man who walked out of his building during an earthquake and was promptly killed by a falling brick. While that appeared to be a freak accident, he explains the man was exercising free will, saying, his higher self, his soul, decided 3 days prior in our time to choose an exit and decided that exit was appropriate for his purpose. We aren't privy to the timing nor the reasons while alive. As many explain it, a test isn't very useful if we know the answers in advance. In fact, even people under hypnosis are not allowed to foresee their own deaths. These refusals to answer are almost unheard of in standard hypnosis, but common when broaching forbidden subjects in regression hypnotherapy. That alone is seen by many as evidence of its legitimacy. We are told our consciousness may leave our body entirely before the time of physical death. Cannon describes a woman whose soul left her body before being burned at a stake. She saw her body screaming as the fire engulfed her. So, take some comfort knowing that people who died a traumatic death likely watched it more like watching a movie. Furthermore, there's agreement that souls are not frightened of death when it's happening. It feels like going home. One of Cannon's subjects described it like pushing off from the bottom of a pool, then breaking through the surface of the water. Another says, death is so easy, it's like getting out of this chair and sitting down in that chair. And one of Newton's subjects compares shedding the body to peeling a banana with one big swoosh. Seth says, birth is much more of a shock than death. Sometimes when you die, you do not even realize it, but birth almost always implies a sharp, sudden recognition. So there's no need to fear death, and I, who have died many times more than you know, have written this book to tell you so. A similar comparison from Newton's subject is that if we were to compare the moment of birth with that of death, the physical shock of being born is much greater. And Seth reminds us that there's no distinct point of death because our consciousness is not tied to the body. It's like how our bodily cells are completely different from those that made us up just 10 years ago. Or how our consciousness, quote, flickers off and on throughout the day and night as you focus in other realities, lose track of time, or enter the sleep cycles. Cannon regressed someone who died as a 9-year-old girl. She said, I couldn't swim. The darkness just closed in on me. I could feel my chest burning. Then I came out into the light and it didn't matter anymore. But she knew the water wasn't deep. She needed to overcome her fear to stand up. So she would come back to Earth again to try to overcome that fear the next time around. I feel thoughts of love, companionship, empathy, and it's all combined with anticipation as if others are waiting for me. It has been widely reported that we see a bright white light during near-death experiences. Regression subjects report that the energy of the white light is so intense that it severs the silver cord that connects the body to the soul. At that point, returning is no longer an option. The soul then enters the so-called mid-plane of existence, like a foyer for the spirit world. Some describe a sensation of pulling away from the place they died and the euphoric sense of freedom and brightness surrounding them, or further away, causing the tunnel effect. This isn't scary, but rather brings a sense of relief. Memories of our beautiful spiritual home begin to flood back into our minds. When the soul has shed the body, it's usually a period of excitement and exhilaration. Cannon notes that her subjects' voices immediately become light and free. But this phase can be very disorienting. Some souls have difficulty letting go of their responsibilities or attachments to the physical world, particularly someone who dies suddenly or traumatically. Though one of Cannon's subjects say it's more likely a problem for a mother dying in childbirth than a soldier on the battlefield. Those clinging souls can take some time before crossing the barrier, whether it's returning to their homes or remaining at the site of their death. Cannon describes how souls may be unsure why they are seeing mourning loved ones or upset bystanders. But she says that we usually understand pretty quickly due to our heightened perceptions in the spirit world once the veil of amnesia fully lifts. Newton also refers to hovering soul syndrome for those who need closure, such as a younger person who feels death as a jolt. Seth notes the dead often attend their own funerals as they're coming to terms with or fascinated by their physical death. Some even try to reanimate their own corpse, which doesn't work. The typical 3 to 5 day funeral arrangement period feels appropriate for souls to remain, to respect the memory of their physical life, and to be on hand to comfort loved ones. In fact, there are 2 vivid stories from my own family of loved ones appearing as they looked in their youth or young adulthood to someone who hadn't yet learned of their passing. Another category of soul who linger for longer periods of time are what we might call ghosts. A lingering soul who's experiencing strong emotions can even use them to focus their consciousness and manipulate physical objects. This may be done for positive or negative intentions. But after a period of frustration, they realize being unable to interact with people makes finishing their work impossible, so they get bored of trying and move on through the barrier. If not, Seth says there's a honorary guard of souls ready to step in and assist in this transition, including both out-of-body souls who are currently incarnating, perhaps while they sleep, as well as specialist souls from the spirit world who are very familiar with a difficult transition. To ease the transition, expectations and beliefs are allowed to shape the initial experience. To those with a strongly Christian expectation, Seth says the spirit guide may take on the guise of those beloved figures of Christian saints and heroes. This limits disorientation during the transition, even if the true situation is soon revealed more accurately. Newton describes some lighthearted scenes where guides and soul group members put on masks to simulate their returning friends' expectations, then soon take them off and reveal their familiar, comforting faces. Our guides become part of our hallucinations to help us during this transition. Newton talks about how each body imprints on a soul, which takes a while to dissipate. So a soul is bathed in an energy shower to restore it. He asks the subject if the ravages of the physical body and the human mind leave an emotional mark on the soul after death. God, yes. My very expression, who I am as a being, was affected by the brain and body I occupied. He also draws a parallel between such transition periods and the concept of purgatory, which is a transitory state of temporary banishment for sins of a minor nature, and the Tibetan Buddhist concept of the bardo, a spiritual separation between lives to absolve evil acts. Cannon found that souls who die while addicted to drugs, alcohol, lust, or other low-energy habits are not ready to reincarnate. They spend time watching the physical world as if trying to satisfy their cravings. This is similar to the Buddhist concept of hungry ghosts. But when ready to move on, they get the same assistance and healing that other souls do and resume the reincarnation cycle. Newton also found that the root cause of many seemingly evil acts is when soul influence, known as the conscience, is too weak to override human impulse. This could simply be the result of underestimating the portion of a soul's energy required for a particular incarnation, or overestimating their current skill level. These souls will likely get an earful from their guide and the elders, but will not face damnation as they go through the recuperation process. In fact, Cannon and Newton's subjects reveal another way damaged souls recuperate and repair energy after a hard life. They can take as long as they need in what some describe as an emerald city, where they get help from specialists. Seth also described an initial stage for those still focused strongly in the physical reality and in need of a period of rest. He says our guides can hallucinate a hospital or rest home on our behalf for a break, or to reorient us to the situation. These facilities are also used to prep new souls for a physical life, such as how to translate emotions into reality. But after we're ready to fully cross over into the spirit world, who do we meet? Where do we go? What do we experience? After crossing the barrier, through the white light, our sources tell us that we are welcomed by a group of familiar souls. We sometimes encounter entities that we assume are angels based on our religious expectations, but we soon recognize them as family or friends from our life that just ended. They often appear as they did in their physical prime. Usually, one significant soul, either our guide or a close member of our soul group, waits out front to greet us first. Our greeters may even still be alive in our most recent life, since souls only bring a portion of their energy to Earth, so they're still available for simultaneous activities in the spirit world. they simply split their energy focus. To continue the metaphor, it's like how you can play a video game while you're talking to someone else in the room with you. At first, we remember the roles our greeters had in the most recent life, but as our veil of amnesia wears off, we remember them across the entire arc of our previous lives and spirit work between lives. Seth even points out that an enemy from the most recent life could be someone we come to remember deserves our respect and even love. The size of the welcoming party varies by person and by life, and it may be skipped entirely for more advanced souls who don't need spiritual comfort after every death. They're eager to get back to work. One of Dr. Newton's subjects said, "I know the way. I don't need to see anybody. I'm in a hurry." We initially take on a physical form in the spirit realm, similar to how we see ourselves in our dreams. And yes, we can also fly and create objects on a whim. Then, after we're fully reoriented, we remember how to display forms that represent our psychological state. If we feel the vitality of youth, we may display ourselves in our physical prime. If we're upset, we may manifest as a lightning storm. We simply represent ourselves how we're most comfortable. This may be a form from a prior life, or a half form from the waist up, or simply a wisp of energy, though we typically maintain prominent eyes as an expressive tool. We communicate telepathically, but we also can use touch to transmit private or intimate thoughts and emotions. And after we're fully adjusted to the spirit world, we're ready for more spirit world activities. So what can we expect to experience next? Religious beliefs, or lack thereof, seemed to have no influence on what they reported. Their answers were basically identical each time, a phenomenon in itself. Once greetings are done, we're ready to get going again. We need to move from that initial foyer area we've seen so far to where our real work happens. Dr. Newton describes his subjects' varied initial impressions of the spirit world. Some see it as mostly gray and white mosaics glittered with other colors, stretching infinitely away. Others see fields of wildflowers, castles towering, rising in the distance, or rainbows under an open sky. Seth says a good way to understand what it's like in the spirit world is to look at our dreams. In the sleep state, we experience a similar passing over the threshold as we experience in death. We don't have a lag between conception and reality. There, he says, you may speak with dead friends or relatives, revisit the past, greet old classmates, walk down streets that existed 50 years earlier in physical time, travel through space without taking any physical time, be met by guides, be instructed, teach others, perform meaningful work, solve problems, hallucinate. Those experiences are roughly translated for our conscious mind upon waking, resulting in the symbolism and hazy approximations as our mind tries to make sense of non-physical experiences our physical brains weren't designed for. After those orientation hallucinations have faded, and as souls progress further, the descriptions of the spirit world become more uniform. It may be surprising that even in a realm of instant creation based on thought, souls need to get around. Newton tells us his subjects universally describe a sort of soul mass transit system, where unacquainted souls travel en masse to their intended destinations. It's described in terms like currents of energy, vibrational strings, or swaying as a ribbon in the breeze. Yet souls may feel a subtle pull helping them know where to go. So that's how we move, but where are we going? Think of a firm but concerned entity who knows all about your learning habits, your strong and weak points, and your fears, who's always ready to work with you as long as you continue to try. After the greetings, the healing shower, and any other detours for recuperation work, our next stop is a formal meeting with our guide. A spirit guide's like a teacher, a coach, and a supportive friend, all in one. And because soul groups often have new teachers in training, we might even have two senior souls guiding us. The prospect of this meeting generates enthusiasm if our soul is coming from a productive life of benefits to ourselves and others, but it can cause some apprehension after falling off the track we set for ourselves. This is where the concept of a soul contract comes in, though the term is often misunderstood. It's not a binding agreement, but more like the work performance targets you might jointly set with your manager for use at evaluation time, or planning out a college thesis with a professor. Dr. Newton details several life plans from his subjects. One involves the soul working on following through on goals. Another plan to avoid being corrupted by power and money, despite temptations. In fact, many seem to relate to the tension between the desires of the ego and being selfless and helpful to society. But another plan was simply to feel what desertion in a family feels like. While you might be thinking such experiences are cruel to subject ourselves to, your soul knows that you are in a safe place to study the full range of human experience. And have you ever considered how violent the video games are that we play in the safety of our living rooms? When possible, our spirit guides prefer a hands-off approach, letting us learn our own lessons, with a debrief between lives. However, they may intervene to give us the tools to be successful or to ensure that we consider our options. Guide interactions are where the idea of guardian angels come from. One of Dr. Newton's subjects recalls her guide being with her on the first day of school. She sat on her desk to comfort her when she was scared. She even showed the way to the restrooms when she was afraid to ask the teacher. Guides never make us do anything or override our decisions. They offer wisdom or inform us of a consequence. They can even turn up the volume on our conscience. They can give us thoughts of patience, responsibility, our parents' love. They give us comfort, support, and even inspire our ideas for creativity. Perhaps they even are the origins of the mythical muse as well. And in extreme circumstances, a guide can even incarnate as someone in our lives, an acquaintance, or rarely even a family member. But remember that we are the masters of our own destiny and can ignore their guidance even at our own peril. It's a partnership with a shared responsibility, but we are ultimately accountable. While Newton and Cannon's methods regularly help subjects contact their guides, other methods may be more convenient, including meditation, self-hypnosis, and prayer. Many people believe when they ask for help from a spirit guide, especially audibly, our prayers are answered. Dr. Newton cites a study wherein 1 out of 10 people admit to hearing voices of a positive or instructional nature. Still, be observant for subtle replies to your requests. Guides aren't supposed to reveal themselves, even when offering help. And guides are very reluctant to interfere with life challenges. To religious individuals, a guide may appear as a saint, Jesus, or even a personification of God. However, it's just as likely that our own higher self gives us the insights or strength to persevere. So whether it's one of our guides, our oversoul, an actual saint, or an angel, those who assist aren't concerned about getting credit that they deserve. And we shouldn't be too concerned either. Like parenting, sometimes guides are forced to let us endure hardships when that's what's best for us to learn the lessons we need to learn. So, how do we know whether we've learned our planned lessons? After meeting with our guide, our next substantive activity is to analyze our most recent life. This visualization of a life can be represented in several ways. It's not a new concept. From the Egyptian Hall of Judgment to Archangel Michael weighing souls on Judgment Day, soul evaluation is part of many cultures. And this is no brief life flashing before our eyes episode during a brush with death either. Ken describes a subject looking out over a vast valley setting that represents all scenes of the recent life. She could focus on any aspect of life to review. She could look at the lessons learned and identify focal areas for the future life. We do this mainly by working with our guide or another master. Seth states that souls can relive portions of a past life during this period of self-examination. We're able to review the entire performance, strengths and weaknesses, and choose whether to return to a physical existence. After death, experience has as much organization, highly intricate and involved, as you know now, he says. One feature of the review has been described as viewing the ripples that we made. We may see the ways we touched the lives of others and the way that these souls touched others as a result. Think of the plot of It's a Wonderful Life, where the guardian angel Clarence shows George Bailey how the world would have been without his effects upon it. While souls may feel remorse for squandering an opportunity or not learning an intended lesson, there's no sense of judgment. All seem to agree that we are our own harshest critics, and we souls are driven to accomplish our plans, the contracts discussed earlier. You might ask whether our souls or our physical brains should be held accountable for moral failings. Newton's subjects remind us that the human brain has no innate ethical compass. He said, "The conscience is the soul's responsibility. Nevertheless, there is overwhelming forgiveness in the spirit world." That said, lives ending in suicide are seen as failures of a sort, and often require heavy healing and counseling to get back on track. But even suicides don't result in punishment, and certainly not in hell, as some believe. However, any life challenges avoided by taking the suicide route must be faced in a subsequent incarnation until overcome. Suicide is never a part of the life plan, and it's certainly no escape from the challenges. But it's a delay of progress. With proper guidance and adjustment, such as bringing more spiritual energy into an incarnation, a soul gets the support it needs to be successful the next time. Now, there appears to be one exception to this non-judgmentalism. The most extreme life situations can damage a soul beyond repair, such as with a mass murderer. The only option is recycling the soul's energy back to the source, stripping its identity. Again, this is an extremely rare situation. So is this a solitary journey, or do we have travel companions along the way? As we progress through the cycle of incarnations, we have a primary cohort of about 15 souls. We are all at the same level of development and move through lessons and lifetimes together. We are old friends, sometimes sharing dozens or even hundreds of incarnation adventures. As a result, we have a playful and supportive tone of interaction with these peers. A common set of guides teaches and coaches these soulmates like classmates. Cannon describes their goal of advancement being just like in a school class. In fact, she says, souls wouldn't want immortality if offered. We would get bored quickly, like staying in third grade long after you've learned the third grade lessons and your friends have moved on. We have one or more primary soulmates among our class group. We tend to play major parts in each other's lives, often spouses or close siblings. This is closer to how the term soulmates is commonly used. But even these close soulmates take breaks from each other, skipping lives together to pursue different experiences. So don't panic if you don't feel like you have a primary soulmate in your current life. And if you do meet yours, don't assume it will be smooth sailing either. Even primary soulmates are there to help us learn agreed-upon lessons, which just might be difficult challenges. And beyond our core soulmate class, we also have an extended community. This is a cluster of at least 1,000 souls. This group plays bit parts in our life. Think of a friend from grade school who you now only keep up with on social media, for example. If our spirit guide is like our teacher, then the Council of Elders is like our guidance counselors. We first meet with these spiritual masters soon after death, and usually a second time, soon before a new life. We discuss the kinds of situations and personalities that would be best for our growth path with them. They are described as wise and compassionate with infinite patience with our faults, yet they're carefully evaluating our life choices and behavior. They do not punish, but through their questioning, they hold us accountable for karmic impacts and the implications on our future path. Dr. Newton's subjects describe the elders as presenting the last station of beings responsible for souls still incarnating on Earth. They are ascended masters, no longer incarnating, so they are above even our guides in vibration level. Dr. Newton says, the council is not so concerned about how many times we fell down in our progress through life, but whether we had the courage to pick ourselves up and finish strong. But where do we get the skills we need to be successful in our lifetime trials? We amass great knowledge here of lessons to be learned, karma to be dealt with. We learn many things about dealing with human nature and the problems I had to face. Also about the problems I will be facing the next time I'm born. Learning and growth are very important to our souls. Edgar Cayce said our plans involve our full being, our physical, mental, and spiritual growth. We may decide to focus our next incarnation on developing our intellect, emotions, creativity, social connections, spirituality, physicality, or a combination of those. Seth describes our self-examination and learning as incorporating our full knowledge from numerous reincarnations. That way, we get access to the insights more advanced than a living personality can contain. We move up in vibration and development along our own path at our own speed. As Dr. Newton describes, the system fosters enlightenment and ultimately the perfection of souls. But the analogy doesn't stop there. There is a group manifested energy structure in the learning dimension. It's an even higher dimension than the transitional area we've discussed thus far. So we can access it only after we are fully reoriented to the spirit world. Here, what we need and want to learn is attracted to us. One particular subject describes coming here to learn about standing up for herself, being more outspoken, and avoiding being manipulated by others. She learned that her next lifetime will have such opportunities. When people refer to hardships as testing them, they may be more accurate than they know. Cannon says there's schools on various levels of the spirit world for souls at different stages of development. There are schools for learning to become guides, to inspire our inventors, composers, and artists, even to become creators of worlds. Lessons can be like a lecture, seminar, or workshop, but we can even experience particular incarnations in their entirety. One particularly interesting tool on the learning plane that Cannon uncovered is known as imprinting. This is a way of preparing a soul for its first Earth life, or also for gaining new perspective down the road. It involves selecting one, several, or even hundreds of lives from the Akashic Record or Book of Life and experiencing it fully. It lets a soul get up to speed on emotions, language, customs, politics, social norms, whatever the need is. It's like watching a rerun on TV, but it's so immersive that hypnosis subjects are unable to distinguish these memories from lives actually lived. This explains why some oft-mentioned stories of multiple people saying that they are reincarnations of Napoleon or Cleopatra or Jesus. But the learning done in the spirit world is inherently limited. It's like learning from a book when only hands-on, practical experience can round out an education. Getting real-world experience, so to speak, is why we incarnate. More than anything else, this is the meaning of life. But Seth cautions us not to think in terms of progress or goodness in traditional terms. Similar to the Buddhist understanding, we are here simply to learn how to be, to create ourselves as fully as possible. So how do we ensure a life provides us with ideal opportunities and experiences? Once our wounds are healed, our interlife meetings and trainings are completed, and we've caught up with our soul families and friends, we again feel the desire for more growth. And for us souls, that typically means the pull toward another life. So the next major activities in our interlife journey support planning out our next life. Newton's subjects describe the decision to incarnate based on three factors. Am I ready for a new life? What lessons do I want to undertake to advance my learning and development? Where should I go? And who should I be in my next life for the best opportunity to work on my goals? There is some debate about whether one is ever forced to reincarnate. It seems more like being strongly encouraged to take on lives to gain valuable perspectives. It's ultimately done with consensus between ourselves and our advisors. Cayce said that once you start in a schoolhouse of a particular planet, we must finish in that schoolhouse. I suspect it's comparable to students in our own schools. Once enrolled in a particular school, we generally progress through that school system. However, we can switch schools if it's not a good fit, which in this case may mean a different planet. We can even drop out in extreme circumstances and take one of the different growth tracks that we'll discuss soon. There are also opportunities for resting if we just need a vacation or a sabbatical. Cannon talked to a subject in a resting place. There, the soul was unwilling to describe it, like she was trying to wake someone from sleep who didn't want to be bothered. Other times, a soul may take an entire resting life. This could be an especially easy life, devoid of serious challenges, or it could be life as a lower energy form, like an animal, or an inanimate object like a rock, which does contain some elemental soul energy. Or it could involve visiting another less stressful planet as a tourist of sorts. Yes, this is related to some of the ET encounters on Earth, but that's not for today's discussion. Newton found over a third of his subjects had life on another planet. One subject described lives on a world with similar physics to Earth. He would go there to hone his creativity in a relaxing environment. He said, "There are no people, no responsibilities, just small animals. It's like a lab to experiment with creation." That soul was working on mastering the proper chemical conversions to form plant life. But at some point, we chose to incarnate on Earth next, for this lifetime. So, how did we end up in this current life? The space of life selection, also known as the viewing room, or even the computer room, is said to be a private place, separated from the main study areas. It's often described like a movie theater, or as viewing a ring of destiny. Here, a soul can review available life options and make a selection. But not all is revealed. That would defeat the purpose of experiencing life. Instead, we see only the key features and challenges that we would face by selecting each life. The most detailed views are shown of the ages 8 to 20, when the major forks in our path become apparent. Also, the further one looks into the future, the less certainty there is due to the ever-branching probable realities. And then, of course, amnesia will obscure this viewing altogether when life begins. The first step in life selection is to choose general plans and goals for the next life. That allows our guide to identify a collection of appropriate options that will support these goals. Next, we choose the environment, including geography, culture, even heredity. For example, one of Newton's subjects wanted to become a musician. He picked New York City, where he recently died young. He needed a location that would inspire his interest in music and have opportunities to hone his skills. Next, a soul chooses a family. Someone wanting to be a musician, for example, would benefit from parents with means who are supportive and have their own appreciation for music. Despite traditional belief, we rarely stay in one family line across incarnations. However, in situations like the death of a child, we volunteer to exit early as an experience for our parents, a so-called filler life, and in these cases, we may later rejoin that family to play an important role. As far as gender preferences, Newton reported his subjects prefer bodies of a particular gender about 3/4 of the time. And while homosexuality is sometimes correlated with lives in non-dominant sex bodies, other times it's just a tool, a way to select a more complex life situation for the lessons it affords. Yet he concludes it is always significant enough to be a part of the soul plan. The choice of a body itself is very significant. While choosing a damaged body could be a way to pay off karmic debt, to experience the pain that we caused others, it's also likely to be a way to learn other lessons in our personal plans. As Dr. Newton says, overcoming the obstacles of physical ailments and hurt makes us stronger for the ordeal. So once we decide on our next life's plan, how do we coordinate all those necessary details to make it work smoothly? The details of life may not be the most exciting topic, but logistics win wars, as they say. We need to coordinate with the key characters in the life in what is sometimes called recognition class. It's described like the last-minute cramming for an exam, so we can recognize soulmates who will play critical roles. It's like actors learning their cues for a stage play. As Seth explains, we may work within a cycle with the people involved. This can be at the family level, with family members cycling through different roles in a set of lives, or it can be a cycle through different races or different historical eras. Or we could even get into a cycle with an entire community, like the residents of one village in one century, reuniting as those of a different village in a different century. Newton and Cannon also describe how we set up indicators to recognize the characters intended to play parts in our life. Think of what you noticed when you first met your current spouse or best friend. Was there any feature that caught your attention? What if it was a pre-established subconscious trigger arranged in the spirit world? Rather than you just noticing a man's blue raincoat spontaneously offering him a ride, is it any less romantic if his soul crossed time and space for him to accept your ride? And how about the girl you asked to dance after noticing her red dress, and then she changed the course of your life, for better or worse? These signs occur when a significant event or phase of our life is about to begin. Now, there are backup signs if we miss the main signs, but our best bet is to follow intuition. Overthinking is an often mentioned reason for failing to recognize a life cue. These planned relationships include those that are deeply loving, when we feel like we're meant for one another. This is also a primary soulmate in most cases. Also, relationships based upon friendship or respect are typically other members of our soul group, and those casual acquaintances are more likely to be the members of a different soul group within our community of the 1,000 or so souls we discussed. But all of these relationships fulfill purposes in the drama of our lives. So once that's all worked out, how do we come back here and get on with it? We often have a second visit to the elders just before rebirth. This is a very private session that people under hypnosis don't detail for us, but Dr. Newton found the elders use this forum to reinforce the significance of a soul's goals for the next life. After that, a soul will likely observe the selected family before rebirth. That way it can learn about what to expect and confirm the selection. And finally, a rebirth. Subjects describe traversing a similar tunnel to the bright white light that is the boundary to the spirit world after death. This is where time resumes for the soul, and presumably where the silver cord is reattached, tying the soul to its body. Now, knitting a soul to a baby's brain is a delicate process. It cannot be done until the brain is developed enough, several months into the pregnancy. This is specific to each baby's brainwave pattern, the circuitry they use to translate soul signals. Some souls don't enter until the time of birth or even a couple days afterwards. Newton and Cannon found that souls continue to do a lot of traveling outside the mother's womb during pregnancy. There's no reason for a soul to twiddle its little thumbs inside the womb. Remember that souls don't even stay put during sleep. One subject described this as a time to goof off and visit other friends who are in a similar position of waiting for birth. They come back periodically and give the mother's belly some kicks. These travels continue through the first several years of life, too. The soul may begin to stick around full-time by age 1, but maybe as late as when the child starts school. And not all souls enter into babies. There's an alternative path for souls who get in over their heads, so to speak, to swap bodies as adults. Such an exchange of souls is agreed to in advance by the departing and the replacement soul, so still an act of free will. This is what's known as a walk-in. This term was popularized by Ruth Montgomery, a famous political journalist who later channeled numerous metaphysical books via automatic writing from her spirit guides from the 1960s through 90s. She presented an extensive list of present-day and historical examples of walk-ins, including multiple U.S. presidents. Dolores Cannon identified a walk-in situation in her very first book, Five Lives Remembered. It explained a woman who had a dramatic personality change the days after her attempted suicide. So we've been talking about numerous souls who come to Earth, but where do they all come from? One reason people have for being skeptical about reincarnation is the sheer number of souls on Earth, a number that grows every year. Are there really so many available souls to support such a program? Where do they all come from? Our spirit world knowledge assures us that there's no risk of running out of souls, for a couple of reasons. First, souls are incarnating more frequently in these more interesting modern times. Dr. Newton compiled a chart of frequency, shown here, ranging from thousands of years between lives for cavemen to more than one life per century now. As far as lives per soul, one of Cannon's subjects estimates that 120 is the average number of incarnations, though some complete the Earth school in 10 lives, if they focus on their path. Others suggest that a couple of hundred lives is common. Also, Seth claims that there's flexibility as to the sequence of lifetimes. Sequence is really more of a matter of focus than chronology. He gives the metaphor of a playwright who first writes a play taking place in Renaissance Florence, and then ancient Rome, and then medieval Scotland, even as he progresses on a linear path through his own development as a writer. Others tend to think of incarnations as generally sequential, but I suspect some of that confusion is because recalling future lives would reveal too much. And next, we're told there's no shortage of souls willing to come to Earth. Remember, Earth is seen as an elite school, part of the Ivy League, so to speak. And Harvard could easily double its enrollment next year simply by increasing its admission rate. Another factor Cannon and Seth in particular talked about is parallel lives. Portions of a soul's energy can be in two bodies that overlap in time. Some call this a twin flame. Mind-blowing, isn't it? And finally, all souls have to start somewhere. And Dr. Newton worked with a soul who's involved in the birthing process of new souls. This is the process of a newly splintered light, split off from the unified energy pool known as all there is. It's given identity, or temporary duality, to gain experience as a soul. It will eventually reunite with the source, along with all of its experiences and learnings. But then what happens after our reincarnation cycle completes? After an appropriate number of lives and progress on our path, we no longer feel the pull to incarnate. We have learned our lessons, experienced our emotions, tested our conscience, and are ready to move on. Again, we do not simply enter an eternal rest. We crave to ascend, to make ourselves in God's image. We probably have infinite paths we can't even comprehend, but we do know about a variety of options. We can, of course, become a guide for cohorts of less advanced souls, such as by apprenticing under a primary spirit guide. I mentioned that we can become a creator of worlds. These skilled souls contribute to the construction of new worlds and repair functioning ecosystems. I'm sure this is an in-demand role right now as the Earth tries to avoid environmental catastrophe. Interested in artistic expression? Become an artist using space and time as your mediums. Can't wrap your head around that? Well, The Christ narrative, in its several forms, is one such time-space artwork crafted for our world's spiritual advancement, as we'll discuss in detail shortly. Another option is exploring the system of probabilities of realities beyond the limits of Earth's physics. This is likely an entirely different curriculum from normal incarnations. Instead of following a single branch of each life, as we've been talking about so far, you would instead explore the infinite variations of one life. Our Oversoul can explore all possible realities simultaneously, or skip around to construct a set of lessons. For example, Seth describes that if you decide to give a stranger a dollar, there's also a version of reality where you don't, and one where you give him $1,000, and another where you shoot him in the head, and everything in between. I find this path fascinating from a science fiction perspective. I think about it like Doctor Strange's multiverses. But how do we and the spirit world fit into the bigger picture? And how high does it all go? When I look at you, I see a multidimensional form in motion, a geometric collection of highly intensified energy with a nucleus that is your whole self. The self that you know is only a small portion of that self, boxed in, so to speak, by its limited perception. So, yes, we are energy, and as such, we vibrate with a frequency. We exist on one of several different planes, which are like groupings of different frequencies that can coexist without interfering. Like how the channels on a radio coexist, ready for you to tune into them. This is a topic with as many interpretations as there are spiritualists, but let's see if we can present a framework that generally aligns with the descriptions from our key sources. First, consider the level of a soul along its advancement path. This is often referred to as ranging from new souls to old souls. Dr. Newton enumerated the levels that current humans belong to along this metric. He determined that, based on his cases, almost 3/4 of all souls who inhabit human bodies on Earth today are still in the early stages of development. On his scale, he defines these young souls as level 1 and 2. The higher numbers describe souls closer to the end of their incarnation cycle on Earth. On this scale, Dr. Newton found the breakdown as follows. Level 1, 42%, level 2, 31%, level 3, 17%, level 4, 9%, and level 5, only 1%. But it is rare for a level 5, usually a guide incarnating for a specific role, to seek regression therapists, so these numbers might be skewed from the actual distribution. The most advanced souls are more likely off doing selfless work to advance human values and other significant impacts. Think Mother Teresa or the Dalai Lama as recent examples. Now, that scale of soul maturity is different from the frequency planes of the entire spirit world, in which humans are perceiving only one narrow band right now. Describing this entire spectrum of energetic beings requires a look at densities. First, understand, we're not talking about physical or mathematical dimensions, like the progression from a point to a line to a square to a cube. That's a common confusion because we humans just happen to live in three-dimensional space while being third-density beings. That's just a coincidence. Instead, think about how fast particles and energies vibrate. Let's use a scale of 7 densities, though there are other scales some prefer. That's because these aren't distinct levels with clear borders, but rather useful breaks along a frequency gradient, more like an analog FM radio than a digital radio. Or think of it like driving on the freeway. All the 70-mile-an-hour cars can see each other clearly out their windows, even making eye contact between lanes, but the pedestrians on the side of the road would only catch glimpses and blurs. Cannon's subjects help us understand these densities and planes clearly. What should not be surprising by now is that beings ascend to the next level by raising their vibrational frequency, the leveling up of your Mario video game character I mentioned earlier. So let's start at the bottom, well below us humans. Subatomic particles are first density. Then the second density includes the so-called elementals. These are collective energy beings ranging from inanimate objects like rocks to plants to wild animals, with domestic animals being a bit higher due to our love and attention raising their vibrations. We also have a plane above that with nature's helper or protector beings. We might know some of these as tree dryads and nymphs, river naiads, elves, fairies, as well as impish creatures like leprechauns, knock on wood. We're told that most of us humans started out in these lower levels as nascent souls before being ready to incarnate as human. Humans, as third density, have the seeds of self-awareness and free will. This starts as a sort of subhuman plane of people without full soul energy, like a psychopath without a developed conscience, or the so-called background people, who are the extras in the dramas of our lives, but not on their own soul journey. They're sort of like the non-player characters of our video game. It also includes the normal human plane we're all most familiar with. Then, fourth density beings bridge physical and higher ethereal planes. This density can be thought of like a buffer for the spirit world. Beings here can project into our density fairly easily. Note there are positive and negative beings here. This includes the lost souls obsessed with earthly carnal addictions, like the hungry ghost concept of Buddhist lore, or our own guides popping into our plane to give us a subtle pep talk. And fifth density beings are completely ethereal. They are focused on evolving toward perfection and accumulating wisdom. This includes the spirit world plane and all the interlife activities that we've talked about thus far, including the greetings, life reviews, meetings with the guides, and planning sessions. This fifth density also includes the somewhat higher planes where the guides normally reside, and the primary learning plane that we may visit between lives. Sixth density beings have finished their personal incarnation journeys and now tend toward group souls. This density includes the elders and other ascended beings. This is where Seth would reside, and as he describes it, "My environment now is not the one in which you will find yourself immediately after death. You must die many times before you enter this particular plane of existence." Ascendant beings only incarnate in exceptional cases to assist us. This sixth density also includes angels, who are on a path without incarnations. Cannon subjects compare angels to the people manning the water stations along a marathon route. Their service is just as critical as those running the race. They just have different definitions of success than us runners. There are several higher or upper astral planes in the sixth density, but we have limited visibility here. Our hypnosis sources and mediums did get hints of the spiritual governing structure, though. Each universe, yes, universe, has its own central council, with tiers of councils below that down to the planetary level. Presumably, our council of elders is part of the structure. There's also a very high plane where the Christ consciousness energy comes from, which we'll get to shortly. And what you've been waiting for, seventh density. This is the unity with all that is. This would be what we would know as God. And if you're having a hard time getting a picture of an old bearded man out of your mind, canon subjects remind us that our impressions of God came from the early church presenting him as simply as possible for the audience of the time. Much of that personification with its patriarch imagery still persists in our cultures today. Instead, think of all that is as the creative force behind an unimaginable number of universes, while also being the structure of all of it. Edgar Cayce puts it simply as, God is actually the consciousness and the frequency of creation. Dr. Newton says, people in hypnosis say that they feel the presence of a supreme power directing the spirit world, but they are uncomfortable using the word God to describe a creator. Every soul has a spiritual higher power linked to its existence. This intelligent energy is universal in scope, and so we all share in divine status. Even our guides are pretty clueless about this plane, but all seem to agree that whatever you're picturing now is woefully inadequate. As one soul says, we are pieces of God to whom he has given personification and personalization for the purpose of growth towards perfection. So anything we view as imperfection are not so when viewed from the God plane. It's merely a limitation of our perception. Like a single cell in our body failing while our overall body is healthy, happy, and appreciates the contribution of all of its cells. So you may now be wondering, with all of that structure above and below, are we truly free to act? You are not programmed. Nothing happens because it must happen. Every thought you have now changes reality. There is consensus among our spiritual experts that we do have free will. The choices we make, even the events that happen to us, are mostly driven by the life planning goals that we select or the decisions we make while in this system. Newton went as far as saying, "The purpose of reincarnation is the exercise of free will. Without this ability, we would be impotent creatures indeed." Edgar Cayce believed that mind and free will are two attributes through which each soul can express its spiritual energy. The mind connects the spiritual and the material, and free will lets us choose whether to be creative in one or the other. He saw these choices as what shapes our character. Seth tells us that rewards, challenges, and dangers exist precisely because there's so much freedom allowed. He said that we signed up for vulnerability as a teaching method. We basically learn quickly enough or destroy the entire system. Scan the newspaper headlines if you doubt the repercussions of poor decisions that humans make. Free will is also what gives us karmic lessons and responsibilities. So let's see if we can clear up the often misunderstood concept of karma right now. I like to think of a lowercase k karma and a capital K karma. Lowercase k refers to a simple law of cause and effect. If you run with gangs, you're likely to get shot or imprisoned. If you do acrobatics without a net, you're likely to go splat. Lowercase karma is a feature of this universe that our souls use to learn lessons, because we are frequently dealing with the situations of our own making. The proper response to this lowercase k karma, Cayce tells us, is to use grace, a magical force of love, as a law that complements karma. While karma introduces stumbling blocks to our path, grace turns those stumbling blocks into stepping stones and aids us in positive transformation, when we are open to grace, that is. Due to our soul memory, we subconsciously tend to replay old patterns of behavior, thinking, or feeling. This continues until we exercise our free will, consciously and with intention, to create a new pattern. Past lives may be a useful tool for identifying such patterns, but the current lifetime provides the opportunities to develop new, more useful patterns. Next, think of the capital K karma as a tool our soul uses when planning a life. This is best explained by a significant case of Dr. Newton with a subject who recalled abusing women during a previous lifetime. In consultation with his guide, he asked to become an abused woman himself in the next life. Let that sink in for a moment. One of Cannon's subjects also made clear that there is no concept of payback with regards to karma. Rather, a soul may want to understand the reasoning behind an act by experiencing the complementary reality, or to be on the other end of the stick. Then, it's not necessary to repeat such mistakes. And remember, when you have an experience on Earth, you are also playing a role in the drama of other people. You may have agreed to that experience for the sake of someone else's lessons rather than your own. So, don't overthink the reasons behind your experiences. They may not be about you at all. And this idea of karma as a tool takes an interesting turn in a finding by Dolores Cannon. She says karma has recently ended as a rule for incarnating on Earth. It used to be required that karmic issues be settled in a subsequent life, but as of the last few decades, it's only an optional tool. Think about that. Because of the rising vibration of the planet, everything is accelerating. We now can simply choose to let go of past soul memories, we can forgive ourselves and others for past wrongs. And then we can simply move on. This is not to say the system of cause and effect, the so-called lowercase karma, is over. If you step in front of a car, you'll still get hit. But your higher self can now choose a path on Earth that is no longer beholden to balancing out our past behavior. Of course, even having cause and effect requires the concept of time. But can we take a forward progression of time for granted when it comes to the soul? Time is one of the most mind-bending concepts for us humans to understand about the spirit world. Einstein was on the right track when he said that time seemed more like a convenient illusion rather than a physical law. All of our spiritual sources seem to agree that time is not a constraint in the spirit world. We have numerous examples of how time applies differently in our soul form, even though sequential experiences are still the norm. Newton reports souls can accelerate time, so days on Earth feel like minutes to them. He asked one subject why he waited 4,000 Earth years to balance out his karma. The soul replied, "Earth years mean nothing. It could have been yesterday." Cannon asked a girl going through a past life whether it was strange to be talking to her across time. She replied, "But time has no meaning here. On this frame, there is no time. All time is one. I find that it disturbs you more than it disturbs me." And it gets even weirder. Seth tells us that our Earth time changes with our psychological and psychic perspectives. When time seems to drag or fly when having fun, time truly does distort. It just distorts all the measuring devices to the same extent, so it's not objectively measurable. Again, think of a slow motion vignette in a video game action sequence that goes unnoticed by the characters. So, does this mean we can see the future? Sort of. When I watch a time travel science fiction movie, I'm always eager to know which version of time travel theory this movie uses. Here's your answer. It's a multiverse, branching away from the present moment for every decision ever made, with each branch having an associated probability. Long before time travel movies, Cayce encouraged us to let go of the idea that time is simply a line that reaches back into the past and forward into the future without end. He would say the experience of the infinite is what connects every moment across the spectrum of time. Future predictions are underwhelming because even the most capable spiritual being is only able to see most likely futures. And even that gets less clear the further out they look. Can we change the probabilities of those branches? Well, yes. Obviously, our actions by free will take us down one path or another, but so do our thoughts. This is a topic Seth explores deeply. He says, "Do not personally give any more conscious consideration, either of you, to events that you do not want to happen. Any such concentration, to whatever degree, ties you to those probabilities. So concentrate upon what you want. And as far as public events are concerned, take it for granted that sometimes even men are wiser than they know." And as that guidance alludes to, all we ever do is now. Now is when we form our reality. Cayce said, "All time is one time, see? That is a fact. It's when we form our past, present, and future. And as Seth describes, through the intersection of soul in flesh. The present is our point of power. It's where changes happen. So what can we know about the future?" Newton and Cannon found the future is often blocked by subject's subconscious to avoid interfering with the planned lessons of the subject or of others. But not all information is blocked. Newton states, "For instance, some have told me that Earth's population will be greatly reduced by the end of the 22nd century, partially due to adverse soil and atmospheric changes. They also see people living in odd, domed buildings." Then Seth takes the idea in a different direction, pointing out that we get a great deal of information from our infinite other selves, the ones who branched off from us during every past decision we've ever made. They're connected to us in the now. So when we get a feeling of intuition, that a choice we're considering is a bad idea, that comes from another version of us who feels regret for making that very decision. Our gut feeling or intuitive flash is that feeling of regret from the future. But why do we have to worry about the difficult situations and poor decisions in our lives anyway, if our souls are the ones who are choosing the course of a life? You are the self that makes the decisions. It's like you volunteered for a day in the slums. It would be ridiculous to resent that decision and say that you prefer to work on Fifth Avenue. By now, two things should be clear about challenging lives. Number one, our souls are not masochists. We only choose pain when it serves a purpose on our path of development. It must teach us how to stop suffering in the future, or how to better appreciate peace and love. And number two, what feels like pain to our body, our avatar, is not necessarily a bad thing to our soul, the eternal one sitting on the couch playing this educational video game we call life. But none of us enjoys hardship, so let's look at how best to respond to the bumps in the road. Cannon reminds us that pain is meant to teach us to rise above pain, to overcome it. The danger is that we must not give power to the pain, not use it for comfort, sympathy, an excuse for an easier time, or an out of difficulties. Even if pain can't truly hurt our soul in a lasting way, we can get addicted to it. And addiction makes it harder to make soul progress. It lowers our frequency. Newton, too, reminds us that soul development is a complex matter where we all progress by degrees, but the important thing is to recognize our faults, avoid self-denial, and have the courage and self-sufficiency to make constant adjustments in our lives. A goal for those on the earth plane is learning what is not perfect. The bad helps us understand the good, and lifetimes that efficiently help us gain understanding are the most sought-after earth experiences. Cannon said no matter how far down a soul falls, there's always opportunity to pull ourselves out of it through hard work and commitment. The lesson is to strive toward perfection, not to be perfect, which isn't possible on the earth plane anyway. Cayce also knew that suffering wasn't for punishment or shame in this realm of trial of body and mind. Rather, a life event that looks like a failure may be the catalyst for a leap of progress by the soul. Our physical setbacks cause us to look inward, while our achievements are what cause us to neglect introspection. Cayce also thought that our drive for competition and our tendency to compare our worthiness with others defeats our compassion and stymies soul progress. So we should look for opportunities for growth from our challenges. Newton spoke with someone who was crippled as a child due to an accident. She recalled an inner voice before the accident that said, "It's an opportunity. Don't wait any longer. Take the fall. This is what you wanted. It's the best course of action." As a result, she became a better listener, thinker, and writer. She told us that, "Even as a victim, we are beneficiaries because it is how we stand up to failure and duress which really marks our progress in life. Sometimes, one of the most important lessons to learn is just to let go of the past." To get out of the funk of blame, Cayce challenges us to take responsibility for our own growth. Don't blame parents, the government, terrorists, DNA, the economy, etc. The essential question is, what can we do right now, considering the limitations, challenges, and hurdles in our lives? And recall, Cayce, dying in 1945, did the bulk of his work during the Great Depression and two world wars, so he and his clients were no strangers to the difficult environments with many parties to blame. In other words, things have always been tough. And that's by design. But what about when we do need a little extra help? Despite their many activities, these departed souls are still able to reach us if called upon. Souls in the spirit world sometimes feel drawn to contact the living. Seth tells us this generally happens from the midplane, that foyer just outside the barrier to the spirit world we discussed earlier. This is the plane living people visit during dreams, as well as the place souls can communicate most effectively. It appears that a common interaction we have with souls is in the days following the death of a loved one. While the average soul is not very skilled at influencing the living, and sometimes completely unsuccessful, Dr. Newton gives multiple examples of a recently departed older soul trying to comfort a distraught loved one. In one typical case, a departed soul targets the part of his wife's body with the least energy blockages, the heart, behind the ear, etc. He then concentrates a beam of energy there to try to balance her body and mind. Eventually, he gets her to smile, or to sit upright, or reach out, and he can feel her shift in energy pattern. He knows she'll be okay before moving on. But he notes that he is available for additional interactions if needed, even after crossing over. Other souls are more effective using symbolism, sending verbal messages, influencing dreams, or other techniques more aligned with their abilities. Newton explains that souls are actually expected to spend time mentally concentrating on helping those on Earth, or other physical worlds. He says that they go to a space sometimes called the place of projection, which is a field of floating, silvery blue energy. There, they project outward to a geographical area or a particular loved one and send positive vibrational energy in an attempt to comfort or effect change. This aligns with Cayce saying that along our God-given growth plan, we may deviate or make an error of individual activity, but we can realign to our plan and get back on track. Or in the words of John Lennon and Paul McCartney, we get by with a little help from our friends. But once we're back on our feet, how do we have fulfilling lives? We are born to bring the creative, spiritual world into the daily material world. First, let's look at the source of our creativity. Cannon's subjects say that anything beautiful in our world is a reflection of something in the spirit world that's even more beautiful. And Seth tells us that everything that exists physically first exists in our thoughts and feelings. He also tells us that our higher self can bring inspiration to our life from across time, space, and even from different lifetimes. And we've already talked about how our guides can be like a muse, helping us with creative ideas. So it sounds like creative ideas are readily available. So what's the problem? Well, intent is the key driver of creation. Seth notes often, you get what you concentrate upon, there is no other main rule. Edgar Cayce adds that lasting change requires us to find a higher motivation, a new ideal as a vision for ourselves, such as love, joy, knowledge, or freedom. He adds that patience and intolerance are particularly powerful because they are such contradictions to the materialist defaults of our ego. So how does it all work? Cayce used the metaphor of the spirit as a light bulb, the mind as the movie film, and the image on the screen as physical reality. Sounds like an easy enough formula. Then why aren't we all Leonardo da Vinci's? Well, it comes down to the disconnect between our desires and our thought patterns. Paul Selig's guides explain it well. I want a lover, why don't I have a lover? I want more money, but I can't seem to keep more money. I want a friend, but I don't have a friend. You can ask all the questions and we'll give you the same answer anytime. When you have a pattern that sabotages your life's intentions, you have a pattern that needs to be cleared. We all know people who want to be healthy, but they constantly ask their friends and family, why am I always sick? Or someone who wants financial freedom, but mentions many times per day that they are too poor. That repetition is a form of self-hypnosis. It reinforces the exact opposite of the belief they desire. This is why visualization techniques are so effective. By picturing a desired situation numerous times per day, we cut through those limiting beliefs by believing our goals can be realized. Understand that our ability to create on the physical earth plane is constrained by design. Sure, in a dream or in the spirit world, we can think of an orange pumpkin and find one in our hands. But here we have laws that we have agreed to as a collective. Some of them are laws of physics, like gravity. But another is the delay between thought and reality. Cannon notes that without that delay, otherwise known as effort, we could have chaos here. We would never have the ability to change our minds or improve our plans before creating. Selig explains it going beyond physical rules, however. He says that on the matrix level, we all agree to things like pigs can't fly. However, he says we're also in agreement with things like I'm not allowed to know myself as a divine being. Only the priest can give me release of my sins. Only the Father in heaven can solve this problem, etc. He encourages us to question and push back on these group beliefs. Like with anything else, we get the energy we need once we set the intention and keep the focus. And you're noticing, we're not just talking about paintings and sculpture anymore. We're talking about branching reality within the bounds of our laws, and indeed, pushing those laws beyond their limits. Seth explains it, imagination, backed by great expectations, can bring about almost any reality within the range of probabilities. You might be wondering, what new world would you create if you had the power? I ask you to hold that thought. We'll be discussing the new Earth soon enough. But now, we must improve our understanding of love. For as Seth puts it, love and creativity are synonymous. As startling as that comparison may seem, this is yet another subject on which our spiritual authorities all agree. Love is the source of all being as well as all energy. A student asked Seth whether he felt love in his reality, to which Seth answered, "Now, what makes you ask that question or doubt that any reality could be without it? For it is the basis of any reality that any consciousness knows." And from what we're told, experiences of pure love are common in the spirit world. Subjects told Newton that souls can envelop each other in light. When asked what that is like, he was told, "It's like being wrapped in a bright light blanket of love." Cannon has a subject describe an experience of pure love shown to her in the spirit world during a near-death experience. She said, "It was as if every ounce of everything was sucked out of me. What came into me was total, pure, unconditional love, and it was so incredible. It went into every cell, and I could hardly get my breath." But what do we do when love isn't enough to keep our bodies functioning properly? You usually do not realize that your physical body is created by you at each moment as a direct result of your inner conception of what you are, or that it changes in important chemical and electromagnetic ways with the ever-moving pace of your own thoughts. Our sources agree that emergency medicine and surgery are extremely important and beneficial. And there's no downside to setting a broken bone or opening a blocked artery once an ailment has progressed that far. With regards to pharmaceuticals, it's hard to argue with a double-blind, controlled drug trial. But think about that for a moment. Why is it necessary in the first place? Well, there are many stories about the placebo effect. Doctors noticed that people in studies improved regardless of the efficacy of the drugs that they ingested or the treatment they received. It seems that our own minds can make our bodies healthy or sick based only on belief. There's a well-documented case of a man whose large and malignant lymphosarcoma tumors covering his body dramatically improved and even disappeared when he took a potentially breakthrough medication. But when he learned months later that the drug shouldn't have worked, the tumors came raging back. His doctors again injected him with water and told him it was a new formulation, and the tumors disappeared again. But when it was revealed that that injection was useless, the tumors returned yet again and he soon died. There are also cases of dissociative identity disorder or split personalities causing physical changes that we don't understand. In one state of mind, they have allergy symptoms until they switch back to their other personality. One personality might have blue eyes, while the other one has green eyes. Those are traits that we can't control consciously, but they seem to be controlled by our mind nonetheless. All of our spiritual experts thought that their work could help identify the energetic roots of health issues. Cayce had respect for prescription medication and surgeons, but he advocated that in all other cases, we need to take responsibility for our own healing in terms of body, mind, and spirit. Well, let's get back to the soul. Cannon and Cayce in particular invited the subject's subconscious to do a body scan to identify energy blockages. This is done by many energy healers today. Recall Newton's first hint of past lives was when a subject pointed to a World War I injury as the cause of his shoulder pain. But how do soul's energy and memory connect to the body? Well, you may have heard of the seven chakras, or energy vortices. These are found in what Cayce called the higher energy body, or the subtle body. Think of the chakras like valves that control the flow from an infinite spirit body to the flesh, regulating and balancing the energy to something the body can work with. Cayce described each of the chakras influencing the body through its linked endocrine gland. Starting at the top, that would be the pituitary, the pineal, thyroid, thymus, adrenals, Leydig cells, and the testes or ovaries. Through these glands, the activity of the mind and spirit are represented in the flesh and can cause health when flowing freely or disease when blockages exist. Cayce provided remedies to clear these blockages. He advocated for holistic, natural approaches because healing must occur in the mind, body, and spirit. In fact, the Journal of the American Medical Association said in 1979, the roots of present-day holism probably go back 100 years to the birth of Edgar Cayce in Hopkinsville, Kentucky. One study estimated an 85% success rate on Cayce's 22,000 remedies. But that's not the only approach to energetic healing. Cannon and Newton also found numerous reports of a healing temple in the spirit realm. It has a jewel-windowed rotunda. This is where energies can be raised, which manifest in the body of its visitors as improved health. This place is often visited between lives, such as after dying after a long-term disease of the body. Such negativity can transfer to the etheric energy body, which needs to be cleansed. But it's also available to us during a life incarnation as well. Some of Cannon's subjects said anyone can journey to this location during meditation, hypnosis, or out-of-body travels with practice. It's overseen by a guardian, but all are welcome. This temple also has a tapestry room. The huge tapestry of multicolored woven cables shows all the interactions, intertwining, and influence of all souls. Some refer to this tapestry as the Akashic Records, or Book of Life. This is a giant cosmic compendium of knowledge. It contains all the thoughts, events, and knowledge throughout the history of every planet. Cayce claimed to guide people to health by viewing their Akashic records. Numerous practitioners today specialize in this approach to healing, accessing the records through meditation or intuition. If our souls can raise our bodily vibration for health and creation, are there any limits to the ascension of our body and what we can achieve? Christ is, in essence, the vibration of God as realized in man, and that it can be recognized and awakened and manifest, you will begin to believe that everything is possible in this world. All of our spiritual sources agree on the basic role of Jesus, yet there's some differences in the details. Their consensus is that Jesus did not describe himself as a literal Son of God, but rather, like us all, he was a piece of God incarnate. But unlike us, he was from a higher upper astral plane beyond our current incarnation cycles. Yet he chose to come into a body to show us what is possible in the flesh, how we too can raise our vibration and reach a higher plane even while incarnated on Earth. He was to be a model for us in that endeavor. This is a role that many served, like Buddha, Muhammad, even some saints like Saint Francis of Assisi, to name just a few. Paul Selig, who focused extensively on the Christ consciousness, explains, "Because there have been many Christs, there have been many teachers, there have been many who have ascended and are the way-showers, and every religion holds these people in regards because they resonate." Jesus' soul came from a plane that is closer to God, or all that is, than perhaps any who came before him. But he is one of many ascendant masters to incarnate out of service to humanity. Some such beings are better known throughout history, while others remain anonymous. Some are even here now. But we are not permitted to know their identities and interfere with their missions. Let's break that down a bit. First, yes, Jesus was an actual man by most accounts. During a clairvoyant session, Cayce saw Jesus' hair as mostly red, inclined to be curly in portions, yet not feminine or weak, strong, with heavy piercing eyes that are blue or steel gray. His weight would be around 175 pounds. Cannon had a hypnotherapy subject as the basis for her book, Jesus and the Essenes, who similarly described him as having gray eyes, reddish yellow hair, and a short beard, slightly taller than average, but slender. This subject, a young college student with no exposure to Jewish historical minutiae, recounted a past life over many months. She recalled being a male teacher in a progressive underground organization called the Essenes. They taught Jesus and John the Baptist from ages 8 to 14 in a secretive community called Qumran. He helped teach them the laws from the Torah, meditation, spirituality, and ancient teachings passed on in their sect from lost history that they were entrusted with. They recognized Jesus as the Messiah from the star charts and prophecies that identified his mother Mary, and confirmed that he was special by his personality as a child. Jesus' teacher described young Jesus as able to explain complex topics of morality, love, nature, and God to his teachers and elders. He would explain even familiar topics as if giving them a breath of fresh air, helping all see with new eyes, often with parables and metaphors from nature. And that was before his public sermons and miracles, both of which came from being tuned in to the spiritual plane. Jesus' soul was ascendant the same way that we're all working towards. As Cayce said, he should be described as the soul who first went through the cycle of earthly lives to attain perfection. He returned to the spirit world, moved up through the upper levels, then returned on a voluntary mission. Cayce and others contrast that with the Christ consciousness, which is the awareness within each soul imprinted in pattern on the mind and waiting to be awakened by the will of the soul's oneness with God. Jesus embodying the Christ consciousness is unanimous among our sources and very pivotal to our understanding here. Most important is to clear up the confusion that Christ consciousness is based in Christianity or any religion. Jesus brought us a message that Christ consciousness exists as an energy of the universe that is accessible to all humans. This Christed state means to be in frequency with the Creator, without separation by the ego. Now that sounds like a tall order, even scary. We don't like diminishing our ego. It has kept us safe for millions of years. In fact, the frequency of fear is the primary impediment to moving forward. But, as Selig says, the fear that has encased this planet for so long is actually being removed. Cayce said that the Christ consciousness will come again in any age when it is needed. And this time, right now, at the beginning of the 21st century, is the time chosen for humanity to reach its destiny. Paul Selig states it as, "This is the moment in the history of man when he has an opportunity to become one with the soul's destiny. This is the time of resurrection of the Christ." And then, how do we raise our vibrations to the frequency of the Christ consciousness? Well, that's our final topic. One man can ascend into his Christ consciousness and change the world, and this has been done on a singular level many times on this plane. It is going to be done now in many, many, many people as the planet begins its ascension into the new millennium of peace, understanding, and truth. We've been talking about how we individually can ascend to the Christ frequency, but what happens if most of us ascend together? This has reportedly happened before, such as the kingdom of Shangri-La or Shambhala that disappeared from our plane using the Buddhist teachings. But could it happen on a planetary level? This is not a thought experiment. This is exactly what those with direct knowledge of our spiritual truths say is our destiny. Whether they call it the Age of Aquarius, the New Earth, Judgment Day, or the Second Coming, End of Days, it's coming, and by many accounts, it's already in progress. Here's another way to think about it. If you overtax your body, eventually it will wear out, die, and rise to the next plane of frequency upon its death. So if you think of the Earth as an entity, often called Gaia, it shouldn't come as a surprise that our overuse and abuse of the Earth will similarly wear it out. It too will ascend to a higher plane to refresh and grow. Those whose body and soul can handle that frequency will join her in that transition. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. We're damaging the Earth with our focus on negativity and destruction. Recall that Seth explained that we get what we focus on. But how bad is it getting? Well, understand that this is not just a local problem anymore, not just even about Earth. Dolores Cannon amassed details about a new Earth from hundreds of clients over 5 years. According to one of her subjects, the Earth's contaminants and negative energy have actually destroyed many planets. It seeps into other dimensions and universes. That particular Ascendant being was working to rescue and relocate the residents of damaged planets while simultaneously working to clean up our low-frequency Earth contamination by counteracting it with high-frequency energy. His original homeworld was a crystal-based planet that dissolved as a result of our contaminants. He said they don't blame us. They know ours is a planet of lessons that exists for an important purpose. It's just that our playtime in the sandbox is disrupting the other kids, so we need to get out and move on now. So what to do about it? As we discussed, free will is the rule of our schoolhouse on Earth. However, the situation here is now bad enough that the Spiritual Governing Council for our universe decided it must act. It has two choices. Option one would be to wipe us humans out and start over. This would not be the first time either. The preferred approach is to let the Earth's crust slip over the core, which causes earthquakes, massive floods, and ice ages. Remember, we're still digging up tropical species from Siberian permafrost and finding them frozen without starving first, as this shift happens rapidly. Sometimes they even give select people advance warning. Ask them to build arcs to help speed the repopulation. That fresh start approach was also reportedly done to Atlantis when their technology got ahead of their ethics, but that's another story for a different day. This time the council decided on option two, that is to enlist a confederation of lightworkers and ascendant beings to help our entire planet to raise frequency and ascend to a higher density plane. We talked earlier about the density levels. Recall that the third density includes us beings with the seeds of self-awareness and free will, and that fourth is sort of a buffer, quasi-physical reality. But the fifth density is the first that's completely ethereal. In that model, the shift we're talking about is raising the Earth from level 3 to the level 5 range. And we're not alone in this effort. A federation of entities under the guidance of a governing council of the upper astrals has been working to ensure this transition for millennia. We talked about ascendant beings that are nurturing the Earth with soul energy, raising it, preparing it for ascension. At some point, it will reach an inflection point. It will then pop, so to speak, and the new Earth will separate over a short time, months or years at most. But recall that densities apply to beings, not places. The people who will cross to the new Earth need to raise their vibrations and thus their body's ability to hold that higher energy. In addition to the powerful higher beings who are helping raise the vibrations of the Earth from other dimensions, there are also these so-called waves of volunteers, or lightworkers, and keepers of the energy grid. These beings, on the scale of millions of people, are helping us, monitoring us, tuning us. These are souls who are currently incarnating humans, maybe even you. They may be here to teach particular skills or qualities to other humans. One subject who spoke to Cannon learned that she is here to remind other healers who they are and remind them what their energies are so that they can do their work. She had exceptional abilities even as a baby, since she needed to incarnate with memory of her abilities to be effective. These human volunteers are often consciously unaware of their assignments. They may do their work while sleeping or simply by being on Earth. The presence of these high-frequency individuals plug into the global etheric energy grid. Others are simply waiting and will understand their role in the new Earth when it comes about, when the veil of amnesia is lifted. Recent branchings have led to an increased separation between those who will ascend and those who will not be ready. Perhaps the divergence of social media communities and the growing political polarization are signs of this schism. But then, so is the growing intolerance for oppression that was acceptable just a few short decades ago. This is exemplified by legalizing gay marriage, Black Lives Matter, the Arab Spring, the Me Too movement, for example. Other beings are raising the energy of babies and expectant mothers. They're modifying DNA and atoms themselves to handle high-frequency energy. Some of these babies are new light workers, here to usher in the new Earth. Others are simply meant to attain a higher frequency than our previous DNA could support. But what will the transition be like? I cannot overstate the impact of this shift. Some who have a preview describe a period of chaos in the physical Earth as the social, governmental, and economic structures crumble, natural disasters strike, and leaders, both political and religious, grasp to retain fear-based power. Higher frequency beings that we've never seen before, including ETs and interdimensional beings, will start to appear to us. Health issues will increase as energy blockages become more debilitating. There will be more pandemics too. Now, those who understand what's happening will help others remain calm and may encourage souls near this borderline to make the jump into the higher vibration. But as one of Cannon's subjects states, don't get caught up with what's going to happen. You've got to focus on the light, and that's the challenge. For these people who are going to be on the new Earth, that's what's going to pull them back. That's what happens to many people who are on the path forward. They've been pulled back because they've got caught up in fear and sadness and regret and the black stuff. Focus on the fact that there's going to be this beautiful new existence, new dimension that many people are already moving into. However, for those who are of sufficiently high frequency and aware of what the transition means, the actual transition to the new Earth can be like stepping through a doorway. Some ascending may be completely unaware of the chaos and fear of the old physical world. They will notice feeling lighter, healthier, and negative emotions will fall away. But others will be aware of the separation. Revelations 21 in the King James Bible describes this grand event with the imagery of a different time. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. It goes on to say, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. So let's follow all this advice and focus on the good our sources expect. We hear the astral beings enacting the changes will direct a great wind of neutralizing energy that blows the physical pollution and the negative energy pollution from our atmosphere, surface, and even reaching inside the Earth's core. This also cleans the vibrations of humans. The wave clears a lot of concepts we hang on to. They neutralize depression, misery, money, religion. We'll understand all things differently and get a new beginning. Time itself will reset. It will become a new page. What will it be like on such a new earth, as these sources foretell? New colors, animals, flowers, new fruit that is perfect for us. It will be beautiful. For example, one of Cannon's subjects describe a new custard apple fruit that is nutritious and delicious, being plentiful on trees. It is being developed by astral beings for us. People can keep their bodies in the new earth, at least for a while. But the bodies will change. They'll be transformed gradually to be stronger, younger, lighter, more capable, healthier, taller, with energy visible on the outside, practically glowing. Physical symptoms of the adjustment period will peak during the transition, but in the future, there will be no illness. the skills of today's energy healers will be shared by everyone in the future. Paul Selig described our body during Ascension as, "The new self, the Christed self, is incarnating in the body you are in. The old self walks away and does not come back because the old self was never truly there. It was always an illusion that you were separate from God. It was always an illusion that you were not loved by your fellow man." Our eating will change. We'll avoid chemicals, preservatives, and toxins in our food. We'll no longer be able to absorb animal protein, particularly red meat. We'll avoid fried food and large meals. Their lower vibration will not mesh with our lighter, faster bodies. We'll consume more liquid nutrients, which takes less energy to process. You can see these trends of organics, vegan juices, and meat substitutes taking off in just the last couple decades as part of this transition. Then eventually, there will be a subsequent shift. It will advance us further to pure energy beings, abandoning bodies altogether. At that time, we'll only use light for our sustenance, as other etheric beings do. We won't age or even die at that point. But what happens to those left behind? Their souls will remain on a path to eventually attain perfection and return to God, but incarnating on the earth will no longer be permitted to work off karma. Their path may continue on a different planet, an appropriate schoolhouse for their needs. They may even return to the new earth in the future when they reach the fifth density too. As one of Cannon's subjects describe it, everyone will be given the opportunity. Whether they can hold that vibration or not is up to them individually. There will be no judgment made on them. But none will be destroyed, as the comments have been heard. They will be placed in an appropriate space for the vibrations that they are emitting. It is, by definition, difficult to plan for an extremely chaotic event coming at an unknown time. Even if not all of our plans come to fruition, it's always beneficial to have good intent, as one of Cannon's subjects suggests. So, what can we do to prepare, assuming this transition is happening? 1. We make choices of light or heavy thoughts, actions, emotions, foods, numerous times per day, even per hour. Keep choosing the lighter options. 2. We need to let go of karmic debts. Simply letting go, forgiving, will serve us well as karma is discharged in the new earth. As Buddhists would say, practice non-attachment. 3. We should not be overly worried about those who are not ready to move on. Do not look back. Fear and grief risk one's own ability to ascend. We must remember that those experiencing the chaos are getting a learning experience per their own free will. And 4, don't worry. Once your vibrations are sufficiently high, you automatically move on to the new earth. There is no way to remain. You can't be left behind if you're able to move forward. And don't worry about young children either. They naturally have higher vibrations, which is why they can often see fourth density beings already. Help them with their emotions and diets, and be a pillar of stability, an example for them if chaos erupts around them. Does some of this sound similar to what religions have been telling us to do all along? To get into heaven or reach nirvana? That's interesting. I'll leave it at that. So, where did we land? Did Moses channel the Ten Commandments? Did the Prophet Muhammad download messages of the Quran from Allah? What of the Nostradamus predictions? The Oracle at Delphi? A farmer from Kentucky? A couple of New York writers? And how about a humble carpenter from a fishing village? For every storied visionary, you can be sure there were numerous less famous seers who were punished or even executed for heresy, sorcery, or witchcraft. Why do we have so many stories about divine information being given to ordinary people? I introduced you to the findings of just a handful of people from the past century who carried on this tradition with the hopes that their findings would reach your ears, your heart, and your soul. It's hard to change beliefs on these topics. Nothing is more intimate to us than our own soul. And in many cases, we've been told our whole lives that information about the divine can only be known by having faith in those to whom it was revealed, those chosen ones. I hope that now you are at least a little more open to a different paradigm, that the prophets of our religious texts were simply a few regular people like you. They opened their minds to new truths, and we can too, through hypnotherapy sessions, channeling, meditation, dream work, or numerous other techniques. Or we can simply listen to the detailed evidence from others with open minds. But we don't have to switch off our analytical minds and accept the dogma. We can evaluate the preponderance of evidence like a scientist would. Read the books by those who seem legitimate to you, or at least most plausible. Compare them, discuss them. Decide if they feel right in your gut as well as your mind. Does anything I've described today resonate with you? Just please don't sabotage your investigation with limiting beliefs. Don't believe there's an exclusive club reserved for people who lived thousands of years ago or who have a special gift. And if Noah and numerous others from unconnected cultures really heard a warning to prepare for a coming flood, perhaps the modern-day prophets are truly receiving details of a coming shift to a new earth. And if not, what do you have to lose by seeking higher vibrations through healthier living and replacing fear with love in your life? As Paul Selig tells us, this is a journey for good, and this passage will be unlike anything I have believed I would encounter. But as I go, I will have the experience that is intended for me, for my soul's journey has its own requirements. So thank you, my friends, and safe travels to your soul.